नमस्कार, मैं राकेश और आप मुझे देख रहे हो टैक्स जंक्शन पर। तो दोस्तों, कल मतलब 1 फरवरी 2021 को फिनेंस मिनिस्टर निर्मला सीतारमण जी ने बजट पेश किया, लेकिन वो बजट रिलेटेड लोगों के मन में तरह तरह के सवाल है, और उन्हीं सवालों का जवाब देने के लिए आज अपने स्टूडियो में आए हैं नितिन भुता सर। नितिन भुता सर की हम बात करें तो सर को 28 साल का लगभग एक्सपीरियंस है चार्टर्ड अकाउंटेंसी की प्रैक्टिस का। सर WIRC में साथ ही साथ GST सर्टिफिकेशन कोर्सेज में हमेशा पाए जाते हैं लेक्चर देते हुए। सर जब CA बने थे तब वो रैंकर करके पास हुए थे इंटरमीडिएट। तो सर हम आपका स्वागत करते हैं टैक्स जंक्शन पर। तो
थैंक यू। देखिए,
सर सबसे पहले GST से स्टार्ट करते हम कि GST में लोगों के मन में कंफ्यूजन है, ये GST ऑडिट जो है ये चला गया है, GST ऑडिट अब चार्टर्ड अकाउंटेंट नहीं करने वाले हैं, CA में नहीं करने वाले हैं, तो उसको लेके आपकी क्या राय है एग्जैक्टली?
बेसिकली प्रोविजन पर्टेनिंग टू द GST ऑडिट हैज बीन डन अवे with this particular budget's amendment which has been introduced yesterday. But for 1920, it will be continued. But for 2021, we have to wait for the exact notification to understand. But in most probably, GST audit won't apply for 2021. But none of us have to technically worry about the GST audit getting delayed because we will have the options of other opportunities which will open up and which each professionals can take advantage of. In the sense, key reconciliation statement has been proposed to be done on a self-assessment basis, which we do typically for filing of GST R9 also. If our clients were to do that particular reconciliation, they will definitely need the help of our professionals. And we talk about the SME and MSME segments or small practitioners, which are located on a pan-India basis. Let us don't talk on a big firms or a very large size firms. When we talk about this kind of professionals, clients are mostly dependent on us to do the compliance. The reason is ki they are good at doing their business. But when it comes to the compliance, they are not aware about all the provisions. So, there is a hue and cry amongst all the professionals ki we have lost the professional opportunity. But I believe one thing very strongly ki when there is a some provision is done away, new opportunities are created for everybody. So there is a room for opportunity. So basically, if the GST audit is discontinued, let us assume it is discontinued. Audits will come up in the form of excise audits and service tax audits, which was very much prevalent under the old regimes. So same thing will continue. If you recall the provisions of the erstwhile service tax law of 1994, there were selective audits were done. Similar analogy would apply to GST audits also. See, none of us are familiar in the sense ki we have done the audits, we go to the client's offices and do the audits. But in this audit, which will be done now, government officials will visit our premises and they will verify the records. They will examine the records. They will ask for the copies of the records, which we'll give them, and we will carry out the reconciliation, which we are doing right now. So the role will change, but the compliance will remain the same. instead of you charging for the GST audit fees, you will be charging for the professional services of representation. There should not be a loss. And plus, I feel ki chalo, GST audit has been discontinued. Still, it has to be approved by each and every state in the union territory in the country. So that will take time. So it may continue for 2021, but chances are bright ki it may not continue for 2021. Let us wait and watch for that particular scenario. And ultimately, this may get integrated into the income tax and the tax audit reporting also for all the assesses what we are doing in GST audit. So the role of a professionals, I don't think would be curtailed. I think it will be expanded, in my opinion.
Okay.
But so I see silver lining at the end of the day.
But there will be some technical issues at government also, because they are taking some data, audited data in income tax department, but non-audited data in GST department. Mm. So people will rely on income tax data. Mm. For example, bankers or other stakeholders who are interested in the database, so they will rely on that data only, income tax data only. GST data will be irrelevant, right? In the future cases.
How it can be irrelevant? Because you take the example, ki when you are doing up the statutory audits of corporates or a non-corporate. Statutory audit, when I say it, is under the Companies Act 2013. Hmm. And tax audit under the income tax form. Just let us say it is for the non-corporate entity.
Hmm.
When we do the reconciliations of financial statements, say if it is a single unit, there is no issue. If there are multiple units, there is a consolidation.
Hmm.
Intercompany accounts are knocked off for the purpose of the reporting of the financial statements.
Mm-hmm.
So that data, we can always prepare each GSTN-wise or each branch-wise for reporting purpose, and it can be authenticated by the chartered accountants.
Okay, it will be
authenticated. I don't see a challenge in that.
Okay.
As long as it is authenticated, it can be, we can look at ki it can be a voluntary compliance.
Means it was
without the force of a law.
It was useless for government to take the audited GST data. That's what we
Pardon?
Are... It means government think that it was useless to take GST audited data. Chartered accountants are already authenticating, so there is no need to audited statements from chartered accountants, right?
No, that is not the reason. The reason is ki there are multiple factors which has prompted this particular move. If I recall correctly, due dates of 17-18 has been extended 7 times. And every time we seek for the extension, which was not warranted.
Okay.
This year has been a pandemic where
18-19.
It's a genuine case. Ki extension was desired. But every time, let us take an example, ki if I have filed my IT returns of 18-19 in September 19, how much time practically it should take for me to complete the GST audits? Because my data is freezed.
Okay. Okay.
I'm just reconciling the data of my IT return vis-a-vis my GST return by way of a reconciliation. It can be addition or a subtraction. Or a reconciliation of input tax credits, which I have claimed in my GST or 3B vis-a-vis clause 27 of tax audit report. It is a reconciliation exercise.
Right.
But what happened ki, lot of people were either practicing in only VAT, or they were practicing only in excise, or they were practicing only in service tax, or they were practicing only in customs. But when GST was introduced, it is an amalgamation of customs, excise, service tax, and VAT put together. So a lot of members were unable to adjust to that particular environment. If you see, a lot of members are still confused about the GST provisions even after the 4 years of GST in vogue.
Okay.
And that is, it's a right way of looking at things. Some people will say, yes, it doesn't look proper, but at least I feel all professionals, we have worked very hard. And even after this discontinuation of 4 years of learning, which all of us have done, that learning will help us in our representation or litigation issues that will arise in future. We should look at it as if it is an investment by each one of us.
Got it. Sir, we'll speak about the section 16.2. The tax. This section tells about the input tax credit from. We can avail input tax credit only if supplier confirms us that you have brought this particular material. What are challenges you are noticing in this amendment?
See, basically, what has been amendment that has been provided as per the budget, ki input tax credit would be eligible only if it is getting reflected in GSTR 2A of the recipient, which means ki supplier has to report in GSTR 1. That is the only precise amendment which has been forced upon by this budget and for which the notification is yet to come. But if you look at the provisions of section 16.2, it says ki person should be in a possession of a tax invoice. Person should receive goods or services. Now this is the another condition ki it should be reported in the R1 by the supplier. You should have paid to your suppliers and supplier must have filed the return, which is GSTR 3B. And if that note is done, you can't claim the ITC. So whatever the ITC that we are claiming in GSTR 3B, it's a provisional input tax credit. It's not a final credit. Final credit gets crystallized once you pay to the supplier and supply in turn pays to the government. It is a confirmed credit. There is a Rule 36-4 which came on 9th October 2020, which prescribed you can take a credit more than 20%. Then on 1st January, it brought down to 10%. But with this change, this will facilitate the imposition of a Rule 36-4 for everybody. Which means ki it has to be reported in GSTR 2A as well as GSTR 2B. Now, GSTR 2B is going to be auto-populated on 14th of succeeding month. Earlier, it was 12th because it was linked to monthly filers who were supposed to file their returns by 11th of a succeeding month for the preceding month. For quarterly, now it has become 13th. So, they are working towards the machinery to implement such provisions of the law. I have one point to add for the benefit of everybody. First condition, I should have a tax invoice, which I can definitely prove that I can comply with. Second condition, I have received the goods and services. That also I can justify. This amendment which has come, it has been reported in R1 and correspondingly it has been reflected in my 2A. That also I can prove. Fourth condition, I have paid to my supplier. That I can prove with my bank statements because for payments would be made by my banking channels for which I will have the documentary evidences, which can be the remittance advice or a confirmation from the party. But fifth condition ki supplier has paid the tax. How can I control the supplier? I have paid to somebody and then I expect him to pay, file and give me the proof. That also summary written. Where is the mechanism? Nothing to verify. Say, there can be similar invoices of the same value can be raised on the 10 people. So he will say, I have paid. File the return. Everybody will show the same return. Does it make a sense?
That is the
it was like earlier in service tax regime, similar provision was there, which was withdrawn by the government. I wish such stipulation should be withdrawn by the government because that is not controllable. Right. This is my view.
Right. You are correct. Right. That is a loophole of the act. I think so.
Yes, it's a triple whammy. I call it as a triple whammy. What will happen? You will pay to the supplier, so you are paying tax for the first time. Supplier does not pay, so you also again pay with the interest. And third time, government will go under the Chapter 15 of demand and recovery. They will recover it from the supplier also. So government gets the money
two times.
Whereas parties to the supply pay three times.
So there is
and the beauty is ki even after paying reversal of ITC, you can't claim it back. That right. is the beauty.
And
so this is a big disconnect.
Right. This is a loophole, major loophole of the act. We are noticing this.
Yes.
Correct.
Yes.
There is another section 50150. The section talks about the retrospective effect of interest on GST liability. What's your take on that?
See, there is a tremendous UN cry about department always insisted it should, if there is a delay in filing of the returns, you are supposed to pay the tax on a gross, that is before the claim of input tax credit. And it was causing a lot of problems. A lot of people filed the writ petitions in the high courts to get a relief. And ultimately, the same matter was discussed in the 39th GST Council. And there it was agreed it should be on a net liability basis only. That is February 2019, I'm talking. And the amendment has come now. The beauty is ki whatever the changes that are proposed by the GST Council, every state has to approve. And then it gets formally passed into the act. That is the biggest trouble. But yes, if you have paid on a gross basis under the force, coercion, or whatever you call it as, you can seek for a refund if it is permissible, or if show cause notices are issued and they are pending, with this amendment, you can say, I have to pay on a net basis only, so gross does not apply, so your cash outflow will be reduced. This is a beneficial retrospective provision. Typically, all the provisions in my a humble and considered view always should be on a prospective basis. But when it comes to a beneficial provision, if it is given from 1st July, why should we say it is not available to us?
Right.
So basically, we should seek for a appropriate defense. And whenever you can claim a refund of such payment if you have done, subject to provisions of the law and time limits specified. Typically, the time limits under the general law is 3 years and under the GST, it is 2 years from a relevant date. So one has to check from that aspect.
Okay. Now, there is another section, section number 74, again, section number 129, section number 130. They have delinked those sections. What does that mean exactly?
See, basically, section 73 and 74 are the demand and recovery.
All right.
If it is found that you have short paid the GST or you have not paid the GST correctly or you have paid in contravention of provisions of GST or you have claimed erroneous refunds, then if you pay on your own, then that is a voluntary payment. It comes under section 73. But if it is detected on account of the fraud, misstatement, suppression, then it falls under section 74. And for which the time limit is 5 years from the relevant date as applicable. And department always takes a stand. It is a case of 74 and 73. As advisors, we have to, based on the facts, we need to prove ki whether it was a genuine case of mistake and there was no intention of a fraud, collusion, misstatement, or contravention, and seek a relief under 73.
Mm-hmm.
That should be taken because penalty provisions and everything will be beneficial. It's available accordingly to us.
Mm-hmm.
15%, 25%. There are various slabs that are available. Now, in this budget proposal, which has changed the delinking of Section 130, it is basically with reference to the freezing of supply or confiscation of a supply in transit. What has happened with the changes that has been introduced by the finance bill yesterday? Such provisions are delinked from 73 and 74. So they are treated as a separate proceedings by itself. So typically when we compare the provisions of confiscation or a search or a seizure,
detention,
if you look at the, I can correlate with the multiple laws because I deal with the income tax as well as the GST on a corporate law. So I can tell you the correlation between the both the laws. If you look at the provisions of the Income Tax Act, which says search and seizure, that is a code by itself. It's a separate provisions by itself. So same analogy is getting synchronized under the GST law also.
Okay.
So with this that has happened, only what they have done a significant change in this particular provision is ki they have increased the penalty of tax payable from 100% to 200%.
Mm-hmm.
Where the owner comes to release the supply due to mistakes by invoking section 74 read with 129 and 130. And where this owner does not come forward, then the penalty is provided at 50% of the value of supply or 200% of tax, whichever is higher. And if the conveyance or a vehicle is confiscated, transporter is required to pay a penalty of 1 lakh rupees. I feel this is the not the provision which is in the interest of ease of doing business. It's not fair. See, mistakes can happen with everybody. Like, e-way bill is generated, e-invoice is generated correctly, but there is an error in part B where vehicle number is wrongly quoted because of whatever the genuine reasons is. for which genuine people should not be punished, I personally feel. Now, another that question comes, ki, if penalty is payable and the man matter is concluded, which is the supply matter which is concluded, for which either buyer or a seller both have paid, either of them have paid the tax, depending whether who has come forward. If the original matter is concluded, why transporter should be asked to pay a penalty of 1 lakh rupees? It really makes no sense. How fair it is? Transporter is the only person who is collects the goods and delivers it to another person. Why? What are you conveying? And most of the transporters, if we look at in these small segments, they live hand-to-mouth life. And 1 lakh rupees of penalty from where they will bring? They will raise their hand and say, keep the conveyance with you, I will buy another conveyance, you know. Second hand I will buy for a 50,000 rupees, still I am better off, you know. It really makes no sense, you know, I mean to say. Practically, I'm just discussing the situation on a practical grassroots reality levels. This is what will happen. Mm-hmm. And why? And the other thing is, chalo, buyer or seller has paid this particular tax, they want to go for an appeal. Now you have to pay 25% of the tax as a pre-deposit money. Why is it? Earlier it was 10% or a 25 crore, whichever was higher or lower.
Bank guarantee, right? In terms of bank guarantee.
Yeah. Now even a provisional release of the vehicle is also done away. You get the confiscation order in 7 days. Order will be passed within 14 days. That time limits were not there earlier. Mm-hmm. It's good you are freezing, you are introducing the provisions where the timelines are perfect. Agreed. But why anything should be done which can hamper the progress of a business? Correct. Mistakes can happen, no?
Correct.
Mistakes are happening with, see, mistakes can happen with you, it can happen with me, or it can happen with anybody. Mm-hmm. If the accountant is not experienced and he has done an error, does that mean the genuine businessman should be made to suffer? Mm-hmm. And chalo, that 25% pre-deposit money, if I don't pay, it matters. Mm-hmm. Does not get admitted for the appeal. I don't have the money because of some reasons. I have lost my business completely. I don't have even 1 rupee to pay towards the pre-deposit money. But my facts are clear and they are in my favor. As I don't have a money to pay for the pre-deposit money, I should lose the justice. I can't file the appeal. Mm-hmm. It's really unethical and improper in my opinion.
Right. Sir, there is another question related to agricultural and infrastructure sales. Being a chartered accountant, I was expecting that government will charge corona sales on rich people, but they end up in charging agricultural and infrastructure sales on petrol and diesel. What's your take on that, and how much will be expensive the petrol and diesel in future period?
You know the story of a cess? Why cess is promoted by the government left, right and center?
Educational, since I have been studying education since they had started.
But why always government insists on cess rather than increasing the levy? Do you have an answer for this?
No.
The answer is very straight. Whatever the monies government collect as a cess, they don't have to share with the state governments. So it comes in their kitty only. Mm-hmm. And they can use it the way they want it to use. Mm-hmm. This is the story of a cess. What reasons they have given, we are introducing this particular cess, and at the same time I'm lowering the other basic custom duty and all, or excise duty, whatever it is nomenclature they use, because it has been introduced under the customs also, as well as under the excise, and petrol will fall under the excise.
Right.
They have played around. Tax has to be shared with the state. Cess is not required to be shared with the state. So it's a game of mathematics. Who will gain the more pie in the collections?
Mm-hmm.
Petrol price, if I'm given today, I'm paying, say, 95 rupees per liter. And few days back, I saw the post, one of the posts I had seen somewhere in the public domain. Sri Lanka is buying, importing the petrol from us, and they are selling the petrol at 63 rupees in their country. And if I look at the maths of petrol, basic cost is 29 rupees and rest are taxes.
Mm-hmm.
If you see the collections of lockdown period, which has been initiated from 19th March till, say, last month, you will find collections have gone up by 47% of the excise. And major contributories are two streams of revenue. One is the
petrol.
The petrol, and another is a liquor.
Hmm.
So these are the, like, you know, golden hens government has got. Nobody wants to share with anybody.
And a big surprise is that they are taking the cess for infrastructure, and they also collect toll also from our end. So they are earning twice. Why they are charging it on petrol, and also they are collecting toll.
It is everywhere. It's unfairness to them, all of us.
Right.
They are developing. I'm not disputing there is no development happening. But when today the development is happening on any corridor in any part of the country, there is a traffic delay everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
For example, I want to drive from Bombay to Kandivali, where I reside. I spend 4 hours in driving. Imagine the petrol that I spent.
Right. And it says you'll be paying.
And that is happening just because there is a digging everywhere. So I am also contributing indirectly to that particular infrastructure, no?
Right.
So it's happening. Everybody is contributing. But nothing is in return, technically. But when it comes up, when it's built up, all of us will see the fruits.
Mm-hmm.
But as of now, it is only one-way street for us.
Right. There are many changes in Customs Tariff Act. So which items do you think that they will become costly, and which items will become cheap in the future period?
Electronics will go up substantially. Cotton shirts, that will go up. Gold, the duty has been reduced. Gold and silver.
Gold will become cheap.
Cheap? Is it cheap now? That is a relative question.
Right.
I can't think of buying a 1 gram also. Forget about.
Right.
10 grams or 100 grams.
Right.
So, customs has got its own visions, but they have introduced a common electronic portal, which is in similar to the GSTN portal, with the all similar features. Okay, you can get registered, you can do the amendment in the bill of entry, you can upload the bill of entry, you can do the changes, you can pay the tax. And if in the last year's budget also, even a tax duty can be paid electronically. Faceless assessments is going on.
Mm-hmm.
So everything is getting synchronized one after another.
Mm-hmm.
But all the developments cannot happen everything in one shot.
Right.
It is a step-by-step process which everybody has to accept. Now, in this budget, the amendment has been introduced whereby every supplier who is procuring the goods from outside India has to file bill of entry in advance, which was happening in the earlier period. After it has come, another person used to file the bill of entry. It's a welcome step. Once I have filed the bill of entry electronically on the portal, the information is shared with everybody. It is available with the customs. It is available with GST authorities. It is available with the income tax authorities.
Right.
And it gets monitored everywhere. And if advance is filed due to data mining, artificial intelligence and machine technology or a technology platforms, everything can be pre-verified before the goods actually land into the country. And one more provision which has been introduced under the IGST Act, certain class of people or certain class of notified goods or services would be restricted, which are not interest in the interest of a country, that could be monitored. At least that is my view. Anti-dumping provisions or can be taken care. So corresponding changes in customs, tariff, rules, procedures, everything has been simultaneously executed. And in fact, I am watching since last 3 years. Okay, we are taking a stand as a country to increase the custom duties, whereby we are discouraging people to import, and which may promote India. Local businesses. It's happening, but everything takes its own time. So it will take its own time. So we will see accordingly how it pans out and take a call suitably.
Okay, right.